Well, it's great to be able to come and share with you again on a Sabbath morning. It is a real blessing to be able to worship in the Lord's house. A week or so ago, I had a privilege to attend a political campaign rally. It didn't have anything to do with the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I don't normally attend political campaign rallies. But right now I am witnessing in the entire world a significant transition in that which politicians have even traditionally stood for. No longer do they come even close to Judeo-Christian values. Many of the freedoms that we have in our world are currently being undermined. It's one of those subjects I have a real burden on. It was really good to be able to meet my good friend Carlo at the same meeting. Thank you, Carlo. It was wonderful to have him come and sit beside me at that meeting. The meeting was attended by both state and federal politicians. To my surprise, the group started their political discussions with a worship. Now, I wasn't expecting that. That was something that came something out of the blue to me. You see, they wanted to explain to people like myself why they were so passionate about their cause. They started to quote some scriptures. They quoted Revelation 3:2, we must strengthen the things that remain. That made sense. They quoted Proverbs 28:4. I took a picture of all they were quoting on my phone. That's how I remembered them so well. Proverbs 28:4. We need to contend with those who forsake the Lord. Now, this wasn't coming from the Seventh-day Adventist Church. This wasn't coming from people that agree with where I'm at. But I'm there saying, amen, amen, amen. They quoted Proverbs 31, 8 to 9. They said, we must surely speak for those who can't speak for themselves. We need to speak for the poor and needy. I said, amen. I said, amen. Then they quoted Isaiah 6, 1 to 13. We need to speak even to those who will not hear, because a remnant will remain. And they did use the word remnant. A remnant will remain. Do you realise how they had my ears up and listening? You know, my friends, today, what I'd just like to talk about, if we can, is what it means to be light in a post-biblical world. Is it more than being a comfortable, quiet, law-abiding citizen? How do I best go about sharing my faith? What did Christ mean when he said in the Sermon on the Mount, you are the light of the world? What did he mean by that? Today, that's what I'd like us to dig into. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, Lord, I come to you right now. I want to say thank you for being our Lord and our God. Lord, thank you for being the light and for calling us to be light. Lord, I pray that you'd be here by your Spirit this day. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Light. It's what the disciple has been called to be. Not just light in some obscure manner, but rather light in a different way. Come with me, if you will, to Matthew chapter 5. And of course, this was our scripture reading, but I'd like to reread it again to you and just pick up just one or two points that I believe are so vital that we do not miss. Matthew chapter 5, and it's verse 14. And that's where we're going to commence our study today. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden. Nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. It gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Do you know, I love this particular passage because I believe it's speaking to us as Christians in the day and age in which we're living. It's calling you, it's calling me, it's calling us, it's calling the church to be light. But do you know, it's not just light. It's light that is set on a hill. Now, how is light that is set on a hill so symbolic? What's it say to you and to me? Do you know, to me, what it says to me is that that light is meant to be seen. You know, one of the challenges that I know that I've certainly lived with probably most of my life is that as Christians, we want to be good law-abiding citizens. We want to be respected by the community, but we don't want to ruffle too many feathers. Have you noticed that? Don't ruffle too many feathers. But hang on a moment. Jesus says that you and me are to be light, and light that is intended to be seen. My question, is that going to ruffle any feathers? Let's just backtrack just a little bit. Who really is the light of the world? Let's come to John chapter 8. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, fourth gospel. John chapter 8, and it's verse 12. And this is what Jesus is saying. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the what? Who is the light of the world? Jesus is the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of the world, the light of life. Christ is the light of the world. Christ claimed to be the light. There is something very beautiful about light. It's unlimitable. Light can shine for a distance. Do you know, one of the most beautiful experiences I ever had was when I travelled into the Waldensian valleys in northern Italy. In that place, as I viewed monument after monument after monument, monuments to Christians who had stood in times of persecution, there was a motto there. Light shines in darkness. Their purpose, the reason for their existence, was to shine in darkness. But John says that as long as I'm in the world, I am the light of the world. Something happens in John chapter 9 here, because as soon as Jesus says this, what you find is the next thing that he does is he heals a man who is blind. The man's been blind from birth. Love what Jesus does in this situation. Jesus is the light of the world. But then Jesus does something very beautiful. This is what he says. You are the light of the world. We read that in Matthew chapter 5. Christ is speaking to his disciples. You are the light of the world. But hang on a moment. Which is it? I am the light of the world, as in Jesus, or you are the light of the world, as in believer? Can it be both? I suggest to you that it can indeed be both. Because through the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit comes into the heart of the believer starts to do what Jesus Christ himself starts to do. Christ is asking his disciples to be that which he also claimed to be. He claimed to be the light of the world, and he asks us to be exactly the same. What does it mean? What does it mean to be light? Do you know, this is probably the really big question in our world today. It's a question that I want to suggest is probably unresolved in the mind of many believers. Can I just start by saying what I believe it does not refer to? I don't believe it means being well loved by everybody all the time. It doesn't mean obeying a politically correct agendas of your society. Does it make sense? Why do I say that? Come to Luke chapter 6 and verse 26. Luke chapter 6, Christ is speaking to the Pharisees. And he says something that to me would trouble many many in faith today. Luke chapter 6 and verse 26. And Christ says this: "Woe to you when all men speak what? Woe to you when all men speak well of you, for so they did their fathers to the false prophets." Do you understand what Christ is saying here? Christ is giving a warning, I suggest, to the church. You see, one of the biggest dangers that we can face as believers is to go the politically correct direction. You see, it's very easy for men to think well of you. You write the right thing on social media and you get acclaim. You write the wrong thing on social media and what happens? The mob will rise up against you. Woe to you when all men think well of you. You know, this is one of the huge challenges for pastors today. Second Peter 1:9 says this: "To be light, you must be obedient to the word of God." 2 Peter 1:9 says this: "For he who lacks..." No, let me go from verse 19. Sorry, first 2 Peter 1:19. "We have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed, as a light that shines in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. We have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to take heed." It is as a light. What are we being called to be as believers? We've been called to be obedient to the word of God, even when That is going to challenge the norms of the world in which we are living today. My friends, if we follow the word of God, you will be challenging the norms of the world today. And in all probability, the world will not think well of you. Now, that brings me to the thing I'd like to struggle with a little bit today. How do I practically share my faith with somebody else? You see, one of the real challenges that I've got in this world is that I'm actually called to be light, and yet, on the other hand, if when I am called to be light, in all probability the world may not think well of me. How do I witness? How do I go about sharing my faith? In many ways, we do live in a world in which many today do not want to hear. Increasingly, faith is a problem to the contemporary mind. Jesus faced exactly the same issue in his day. Exactly the same issue. You see, he was living in the bubble of Judaism. But that was contained within a wider world of polytheism everywhere. How did Jesus witness? I love what I find in the Word of God. Do you know, there are two things that I believe Jesus did that enabled him to be able to make such an impact. The first thing he did was he learnt how to ask questions. What's the first skill in being able to witness to my friends, to my children, to those that are at work? When the person at the photocopier comes to me and makes a statement that I disagree with, that I could preach a sermon about, how can I respond to them? Do it the way Jesus did it. I love the way Jesus did it. The way Jesus did it was he asked questions. Now, just have a look at some of these questions. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6 and let's see if, could you do any of these types of things? Matthew chapter 6, and it's verse 28. And this is what Jesus is saying. So why do you worry? Or to put it another way, why are you anxious about clothes? Why are you anxious? My friends, Jesus is starting the conversation with a question. Why are you anxious? Is that something that you could ask in your work environment? Why are you anxious? Yes? That's something that, you know, to me, I believe most of us, Jesus is saying, these people are worried about clothes. Why are you anxious? We can just simply ask that question. I love what Jesus actually did here. Come to Matthew chapter 8 and verse 26. And okay, this one's a little bit of a reciprocal type question. And Jesus said to them, why are you what? Fearful. Why are you fearful? My friends, can you think of people out there today in your work environment, in your family environment, that you could just simply say to them, why are you worried? Is that an unreasonable question? It's not an unreasonable question. Goodness me, Jesus is doing this. I love Matthew chapter 11 and verse 8. And This is Christ here. And by the way, there are hundreds of these. I actually started to compile a little bit of a list, and I actually did actually then go on to the internet and do a little bit of a search, and I just found that people had started to compile these. There are hundreds of them. Matthew 11 and verse 8. He's talking about John the Baptist. But what did you go out into the desert to see? He's simply asking a question. It's all he's doing here. It's a little bit of a reciprocal question, that one there. But I love Matthew chapter 20 and verse... There's nothing that we couldn't do in this particular one. Matthew chapter 20 and it's verse 30, 32. Now, here, what we have is the people have brought a blind man to him. And the blind man. So Jesus stood still and called them. And he said to the blind man, "What do you want me to do for who?" My friends, could you say to somebody, "What do you want me to do for you?" Is that a reasonable way of witnessing? Why would Jesus do this? Now look, do you accept that Jesus is all-knowing? He had perfect knowledge. He understood everyone's needs perfectly. A blind man comes to him. He wants healing. Why didn't Jesus just turn around and say, "Be healed"? He doesn't do that. Instead, he turns around and he asks a question. He says, "What do you want me to do for you?" My friends, the things that Jesus does repetitiously in the New Testament, Jesus does two things and he does them to absolute perfection. Now, look, if you're like me, sometimes you've got to actually sit down and prepare your question beforehand. You know you're going to talk to somebody. I'm not clever enough to do what Jesus does. But you know I've got somebody at work that I want to witness to, sometimes I've actually got to give it some thought beforehand. I'm going to ask a question. What's the question I'm going to ask? Don't I wish I could do what Jesus was doing? Don't I wish I could do that? I'm not that smart. Jesus was asking questions. My friends, you know, one of the huge challenges with the whole Christian faith sometimes is that we have all the answers. Do you recognise that as a problem? I love Luke chapter 10, verse 26. Have a look at this one. Love this one. Luke 10 and verse 26. And this is what... 10 and verse... Verse 26. We have the parable of the Good Samaritan about to be told. "Behold, a certain lawyer," verse 25, "stood up and tested him, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?'" He's been asked a question. How does he respond? He responds with a question. Have a look at this. "And he said to him..." Now, often when we've read this response of Jesus, we take this as being a statement. But if you look in my Bible, the end of this first statement, there's a question mark. And Jesus said to him, "What is written in the law?" Question mark. "How readest thou?" Question mark. Do you get this? A man has come to Jesus. "What do I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, if someone asked you that question, "How do I find salvation?" what would you do? Ah, my brother, let me tell you how you find salvation. Well, firstly, what I want you to do is I want you to come and pray the sinner's prayer. It's important to come to Jesus Christ. It's important to... Jesus didn't witness that way. He said, what do you think? My friends, I've been asked, how do I witness? Jesus did it two ways. He asked questions. Do you feel you can ask questions? You know, if you're at work at the photocopy machine, someone says something to you that is challenging to your Christian faith. You don't have time to preach him a sermon. You want to be able to maintain the discussion, maybe in the lunchroom. How do you do it? Ask a question. What do you think? Do you know, I love what Jesus is teaching here. What's the second thing? Anybody? What's the second thing? What's the second key to witness? Prayer. Yeah. You need to pray that the Lord will open the door. That's certainly true. Prayer is vital. Yeah, I give you that one. Maybe I should have made this three things. Prayer is absolutely vital. But that wasn't the one I was thinking of. I will pay that one. Listen. Yeah. Listen to the answer. Important. Anybody else? I'm going to suggest to you the second. What was another skill that Jesus had beyond anything that we can even ask or think? He could heal. Jesus told stories. Jesus told stories. My friends, sometimes people have sort of said to me, look, how can I? Christ told stories, and there are so many in the New Testament, I'm not even going to go to any of them. He told stories from nature. He told stories from work. He told stories from society. He told stories from day-to-day living. On one occasion, he says, you guys remember that tower that fell down, that killed a dozen people, and he took an illustration from that. And he, you know, in his day, some tower has fallen down, and suddenly he finds an illustration of it. He asked questions, then he told stories. Now, my friends, can you tell stories? Jason tells excellent stories. Now, for those of you who weren't here this morning, for Sabbath school, it was a brilliant Sabbath school because Jason shared his testimony. It was quality. We're going to have Jason preaching by the time we're finished, but it was really, really appreciated what you did. Jason shared his testimony this morning. Now, do we need Jason to go and tell his testimony to everybody out there? Amen? Yes? How many of you got 20 minutes, 25 minutes at work to listen to Jason's testimony? You know, look, if you can hear Jason's testimony, please, if you've missed out, go and nab him over lunch and he'll tell you. You've got 20 minutes over lunch to tell him for him to tell you his testimony. But, you know, the thing that stands, that impresses me is that if somebody says, has your week been? How do we normally respond? Good, thanks. If I said, my God has been so good. Is that part of my testimony? You know, what I don't need to do, when I originally learnt, I well remember very early in my ministry, we had the conference put on a program for newbies in ministry and those who wanted to learn to witness. And one of the things we had to learn was how to tell our testimony. And so we had to write it down. And then we had to be able to share it in about 3 minutes. I had real trouble doing mine in about 3 minutes. But then they said this to us. They said, now, guys, what we want you to do is to go door to door. We want you to tell your testimony to the people on the door. Well, At that point, I'd never gone door to door. Well, I had actually. I'd gone to door a fair bit actually. But I've got to admit, I'd never told my testimony on the door. How many people were interested in my testimony on the door? I did actually hear, I did actually get, there was one lonely person who did want to listen to my testimony. There was one. But I visited a lot of homes to get that one person. You see, most people didn't want to hear my testimony. I've since learned that testimony is something totally different. You see, how many testimonies do I have? I have hundreds. I have hundreds. When I say, when God says, when someone says to me, "How's your day been?" and if I choose to respond and I say, "God's been good," it's part of my testimony. You know, it's when I turn around and I tell just a little bit of my story. My children or my grandchildren ask me something that can be related to spiritual things, and I respond with a spiritual answer. I respond with a word from the scriptures. You know what that's called? That's my testimony. I'm at school. One of the young people says something where I can fit in a spiritual response. Maybe something about my own life. That's my testimony. How did Jesus respond to his people? He did two things. He asked questions. He told stories. You know, my plea is that as the family of God, we'll be asking questions, telling stories to our children, to our grandchildren, to our students, to those that we come in contact with, to each other. Because that's the way that Jesus blessed his world. Now, just a word of encouragement, if I can, just as we finish. Sometimes people say to us, "Pastor, I don't feel very much like light. I feel like I'm a failure." Have you ever felt that? Let me encourage you. Come to 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 9. I love this particular passage. It's the Apostle Paul. He's writing. Now, this particular passage, you understand, is early in the Apostle Paul's ministry. It's early. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 9. And Paul says this, "For I am the what of the apostles? I am the least of the apostles, who am not worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God." Now, he's very early in his ministry. He calls himself the least of all the what? Of all the apostles. Now, there are 12 apostles. He's also been adopted as an apostle. He says, "I'm the least of all the apostles." Well, let's move on. We now move to the middle of his ministry. Let's come to Ephesians chapter 3. Ephesians chapter 3, and it's verse 8. And we're now, this book's written towards the middle of Paul's ministry. "To me, who am less than the least of the what?" Paul starts his ministry and he says, "I am the least of all the apostles because of the huge mistakes that I've made in my life." Towards the middle of his ministry, he says, "I'm not just now the least of the apostles, but I'm the least of what? The saints. I am the least of the saints." Come to 1 Timothy chapter 1. And of course, this is the last book that Paul ever comes to write. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 15. He's about to be beheaded for the Christian faith. 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 15. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom what? Who's chief? Paul. Guys, the Apostle Paul starts his ministry. He's accepted Jesus Christ, but he gets on with sharing light. But he says, I'm the least of the apostles. Halfway through his ministry, he gets on with sharing light, but he says, I'm the least of all the saints. At the very end of his ministry, as he looks at himself, he just turns around and says, hey, I'm the chief of sinners. And he gets on with sharing light. Do you see what's happening here? Have you ever thought of yourself as a person who isn't sharing great light? You know, I believe there's certainly opportunity for all of us to grow in knowledge and understanding. As I look at the Word of God, I stand in awe at what the church has been called to do, the impact that it's called for this world. You know, this next week, we've actually got next Sabbath, we've got Dr. Neil Schofield. He's coming to join us here in our church. The reason he's coming is because we want to start this process of strategic planning. We want to start asking the question, how can our church be incredible light to this world? What training do we need to put in place? What evangelistic programs do we need to put in place? What physical programs do we need to put in place? We want to grow and develop the Brighton Adventist Church. We want this church to become a light in this community. But we're really conscious that we do actually need to be able to make plans to that end. Now, Neil's actually coming next Sabbath. He'll be preaching here next Sabbath morning. I'd encourage you to please come to Sabbath school. Please come to the worship service. Plan to stay for lunch. We're having a potluck lunch, so please bring something along. And then in the afternoon at 2:30 here in the church, he's going to be taking an afternoon program as well, where we're going to be digging into this issue. Guys, the one thing I'd plead with you this week, please remember this process in prayer. This week, as you spend time in your devotional time, please pray that the Lord will bless both next Sabbath and also this process. Guys, we really do want to invite you along, because we want this individually. We want us to be light in our community, and in our church, we want our church to become light in this community. May the Lord abundantly bless you.